They just walk out. I got it.
We stand and sing with us this hymn, O Worship the King.
O worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion in splendor and girded with grace.
Oh, tell of his might.
Oh, sing of his grace. His robe is the light and canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunderclouds form. And dark is his path on the wings of the storm.
You alone,
and you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders a tongue can recite. You breathe in the air, you shine in the light.
Oh, measureless might,
ineffable love, while angels delight to worship above. Thy mercies, how tender, how firm to the end. Our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
You alone,
and you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders of what tongue can recite. You breathe in the air, you shine in the light.
Sing that again, you alone.
And you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders what tongue can recite. You breathe in the air, shine in the light.
Oh, worship the King,
all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. His shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion in splendor and girded with grace.
Amen. To you alone be all praise and honor. You alone are the matchless King. That little word alone is the key there. Could somebody follow you around today and see that Jesus alone absorbed the greatest part of your attention? Could they look at your checkbook and could they see that Jesus alone was absorbing a great deal of your resources? Could they look at how you are organizing your life and the dreams that you have and see that Jesus alone truly is the matchless King and our Lord? All the peoples in the history of the world that we've ever found have had some kind of religious expression. But for Christians, it's not simply having a form of religious expression. This is my religion. This is what I do on Sunday mornings. It is having a life in which Jesus alone is the supreme source of all authority, the supreme guide for everything we do, the supreme arbiter of all of our disagreements and all of our bumps and bruises and relationships along the way. Jesus and Jesus alone must be King. We all have Him along, but we must have Him alone. I'm going to ask Dr. Steve Eccles if he would come and join me here. Dr. Eccles is the Associate Dean of our Professional Doctoral Program and has been working with our preacher for the day throughout his life as a student here in this degree. Would you please come?
Father, we thank You for the opportunity to worship today, to be able just to focus on what really matters. Lord, just to clear away all the things that cloud our minds and keep us from having the right priority. We're so grateful for Brother Stan, his calling, the wonderful church, the wonderful pastor he serves with, and the opportunity You've given him. Lord, just anoint him today. Bring that word we need to hear, Father. we may have open, receptive hearts, that we may do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Before you sit down, turn to somebody next to you and shake a hand or two and just remind the folks around you, don't crowd Jesus. Let him be alone. Would you do that? Thank you so very much. We do welcome you to this time of worship and praise on the campus of New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. What a wonderful week it is in chapel as we are hearing from our graduating seniors in several of our different degree programs. We heard from a graduating senior in the MDiv program yesterday, and today we're hearing from a graduate in our DMin program who'll be graduating in May with the Doctor of Ministry degree. We're so thrilled and pleased and excited to have Stan Lewis as our guest. Now, I want to say we really need to be praying for our preacher for the day. He told me before the service that his topic was how to straighten out a troubled pastor, and unfortunately his pastor surprised him and showed up for the day, so I don't know what that's going to do to his sermon. I'm just kidding, Ted. Excuse me, Stan. But I do think it would be good, since we have Dr. Ted Traylor here, pastor of Olive Baptist Church, where Stan serves on staff, to let him come and introduce to you his staff member. So, Brother Ted, since you're surprising Stan, I'm going to surprise you. And I thought nobody could do a better job of introducing Stan to this crowd than you could. So please tell us who our preacher for the day is. Would you do that? And by the way, I hope you will be here in a couple of weeks, April 12th. Dr. Traylor and some folks at church will be back. They have decided to give us a very special kind of scholarship. They are going to begin taking at least once a year a faculty member and spouse on a mission trip experience with them. And we're going to formalize that on April 12th. Olive Baptist has been a great partner of New Orleans Seminary, and we're so grateful for this new step of partnership that they're taking with us. Dr. Traylor, please introduce Brother Stan to us.
Thank you, Mr. President. What a joy it is to come and be here today, and my sweet wife, Liz, with me. And we did get up a little early this morning, decided to drive over to New Orleans and surprise Stan and Kristen and be here for this very important day. Our church has walked through a lifetime with Stan and Kristen. Kristen's a part of our family at the Olive Church in Pensacola, and Stan came there and worked for us. He is now in his 8th job with us at Olive Baptist Church. He started working out in our rec department, just cleaning sports fields, that kind of stuff. He then went off to school, came over this way, and came back, and he's working singles and young adults and all kinds of different positions. But just a few years ago, I watched Stan Lewis struggle with laying aside his commission in the Navy and to say, Pastor, I'm not sure what I should do, and we began to pray through and look at that. And he still keeps that Navy cover in his office today as a reminder of where he's been. And, of course, he touches a lot of our military people there. But that was the transitional time in his life when he laid aside that chaplaincy step and stepped toward the pastoral role and has then come to serve alongside me in doing adult ministry and then pastoral care. Now serves as my associate pastor at the Olive Baptist Church. He and his sweet wife, Kristen, have three lovely girls that I hope all of you would get to meet one day. They are the joy of his life. And if I have anybody in my life that knows me, that serves alongside of me and takes care of me, it is Stan Lewis, soon to be Dr. Stan Lewis. And we've already been calling him that for these last few weeks. Didn't give him a raise, but we gave him a title. So thank you very much. And, I have not a dear friend in ministry in all the world. And Stan, I love you. Thank God for you. And we'll hear you gladly as you come and deliver the Word of God to us today. We love you. Thank you.
Let's now prepare our hearts with another time of worship and get our Bibles ready for a message from His Word.
This is Job 37, verse 14. Hear this, O Job. Stop and consider the wondrous works of God. Do you know how God lays His command upon them and causes the lightning of His clouds to shine? Do you know the balancing of the clouds, the wondrous works of Him who is perfect in knowledge? You whose garments are hot when the earth is still because of the south wind, can you, like Him, spread out the skies hard as a cast metal mirror? Teach us what we shall say to Him. We cannot draw up our case because of darkness. Shall it be told him that I would speak? Did a man ever wish that he would be swallowed up? And now no one looks on the light when it is bright in the skies, when the wind has passed and cleared them. Out of the north comes golden splendor. God is clothed with awesome majesty. The Almighty, we cannot find him. He is great in power. Justice and abundant righteousness he will not violate. Therefore men fear him. He does not regard any who are wise in their own conceit. Would you stand with us and sing this song just about the greatness of God?
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, and all the earth rejoice, and all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice.
How great is our God!
How great is our God! Sing with me, how great is our God! And oh, see how great is our God!
Age to age,
and age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. And the Godhead, three in one, Father, Spirit, and Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb.
Sing how great,
and how great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God. And oh, see how great is our God.
Sing that again. How great is our God?
How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? Oh, see how great is our God?
Sing that. Just your voices. How great
and how great. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say,
blessed be your name in a land that's plentiful.
Blessed be your name in a land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, when I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name.
Your name.
And sing every blessing.
And every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. And blessed be your name. And blessed be the name of the Lord. And blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name. When the sun is shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name.
And every blessing. And every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, and blessed be your name. And blessed be the name of the Lord, and blessed be your glorious name.
Sing this, you give and take.
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take. God, you give and take away.
Give and take away.
My heart will choose to say, oh, blessed be your name. You give and take, God, you give and take away. And you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name, and blessed be the name of the Lord, and blessed be your name, and blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name, and blessed be the name of the Lord, and blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, and blessed be your glorious name. Now I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Sing all that again. I'm forgiven.
And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Amazing love,
an amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? An amazing love, I know it's true. And now it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Sing, I'm forgiven.
And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Amazing love.
An amazing love, how can it be? And that you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, an amazing love, I know it's true. But now it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Men, sing this with me.
And you are my King. You are my King.
Sing that out, men.
And you, ladies, join us, are my King. And you are my King. An amazing love, how can it be? And that you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, an amazing love, I know it's true. And now it's my joy to honor you.
Sing amazing love one more time.
An amazing love, how can it be? And that you, my King, would die for me. An amazing love, I know it's true. And now it's my joy to honor you. In all I do, I honor you.
In all I do,
in all I do, I honor you.
In all I do,
in all I do, I honor you.
It's truly an honor to be with you today. I never expected to have an honor of speaking in the chapel of the seminary in which I attended and I'm still attending and hopefully will graduate from here in a few weeks. Dr. Kelly, I want to say thank you for extending this honor to me, and Dr. Eccles, who recommended me for this, thank you very much. It's a joy to be here. I was nervous enough to come here and to speak to this student body, but also professors who are tremendous preachers. And then when we drove up this morning from the Providence House, I looked over and saw my pastor's car. And, well, that was a moment right there, because all of those examples that I was going to preach about today, I had to rewrite. All those things I just had to scratch. So I'm going to struggle today with what I've got to preach on. But it is truly an equal honor to have my pastor today with us. Thank you, Pastor. My wife, Kristen, is with me, and she is the joy of my life, has been with me on this journey through the MDiv and now the DMin, and she has been there and has helped me so much. And, honey, thank you so much. I love you. I want to speak to you today on setting goals. Out of the book of Proverbs, the Bible tells us, in Proverbs 16, in verse 3, it says, commit your works to the Lord, and your thoughts will be established. 10 years ago, I graduated from this institution, and it was also the 10th anniversary of me graduating from high school. And we went to my high school graduation, and I was very nervous about that. I didn't know what to expect. When I graduated from high school, I was one of those people, as they say, that made the top half possible of the class, and just didn't know what to expect. I figured all these people who had graduated with me were going to be very successful and very focused people, and I was amazed when I got there to see so many folks who I knew had potential in life, and yet they had seemingly done nothing with their lives. Many of them were still in the same rut they were in when they were in high school, doing the same things. Same habits and patterns that were destructive. And there was another group that some of them I had never expected, and I was one of those, that they had gone on into education and gone into careers, and seemingly were doing very well. And these people were very goal-oriented people, very focused people. And it was interesting to see the diversity between the two groups, of those who had goals in their life and those who did not. Not all those people were Christians, but they had certainly had a life that was focused. You know, God has created us as a being to have goals in our lives, to be focused toward an objective. He has created us to have a heart and to have a soul in which He wants us to move forward toward the goals that He has for us. You know, the reason for this, number one, people need a challenge. We need to be challenged. I'll never forget the first time I met a professor here. He had just come from, I believe, a place called Ouachita Baptist College. I believe that's the name of it. And he had a flat top, and I'd somehow signed up for one of his classes unknowingly, not knowing what kind of professor he was. I knew I couldn't pronounce his last name. And he was tough. You know, you kind of gamble on that. You're just like, well, maybe this guy's going to be pretty easy. It'll be easy. And this was one of the toughest professors I ever had. Dr. Bayerjahn, that first semester, I mean, he slayed us. It was really hard. And I found myself the next semester signing up for his class again. Going, what are you thinking? Why are you taking this guy's class? And the reason why, because he challenged me. I learned so much in his classes that I took as many classes with Dr. Bayerjahn as I could because I needed a challenge, and he challenged me. And so I've had two interns that have just started this past semester, and they said, well, who are some professors I need? I said, well, hey, take Dr. Bayerjahn. It's an easy grade. It's an easy grade. I didn't know what kind of grade they'd get, and so I believe they're now in Dr. Bayerjahn's class, and I hope you guys are doing well, but I've already heard back that they're really enjoying his class, and they're like, oh, he's hard. He's really tough. I said, man, we're learning a lot. People need a challenge. God has created us to be people who need to be challenged, but also we need to be focused. God wants us to be focused on an objective. Never forget sitting in one of the classes, Dr. Spar, he had just started teaching as well, and there were a few of us that were kind of, well, we were just a bunch of knuckleheads cutting up in his class, and he was struggling trying to get through this material. I mean, he was really focused, and we're up there cutting up and just laughing and carrying on. And he looked up, and you know, and of course he's in psychology and counseling, and in his most gentle, attending way, with that great counseling demeanor, he said, "Is something funny?" He said, "If something's funny, you need to tell the whole class." And he's looking right at me. I'm like, "Okay." If it'll take about a week for them to, you know, go through all the process of kicking me out of school, and in that time, I could probably contact Southwestern. They'll get me in the program next semester. I'll just miss one semester. Well, what was Dr. Spar doing? He was focusing this group of students that had kind of lost their compass in the class, and we kind of worked through that, and I appreciated that. But he really helped us that semester to kind of get focused again. And God, He's created us as people who we need to be challenged, we need a focus, but also we need a sense of accomplishment. And so we are goal-oriented because we want to accomplish things. My good friend Dr. Nave is here, and a few years back there was a little rain shower that came through this place on May 8th, and I think it dumped about 13 inches in about 3 or 4 hours, and all kinds of flooding going on here. And so two brilliant guys, we decided we were going to go ride our bikes throughout the city in all this flood water. And we drove past the airport out here, and then we were coming back past Bartholomew Golf Course out here. Now, I've played this course many times, and all you could see out there were the tee boxes and the greens. The rest was just completely underwater. And so we decided we were going to just ride out on this course, and there was one long par 5, the straightaway. I said, "Jeff," I said, "I'll beat you to the other end, down to the green." Well, he was needing a challenge and wanted a sense of accomplishment, so he said, "Let's go." And so we start, you know, racing through this water, and you can't see a thing. And I kind of let Jeff get out in front of me a little bit, knowing that about halfway down, there's a big ditch. And all of a sudden, Dr. Nave, his bike, all go out of sight. Whoosh. And he comes up, and he's pretty angry with me. He's like, you knew that was there. You knew it was there. And, of course, now he's one of my doctoral readers, and I'm probably going to pay for that. So that always comes back. Well, God has made us people who are goal-oriented. And I want to talk today about a guy in the Old Testament who was very goal-oriented, and that is Caleb. And I want you to turn with me to Joshua chapter 14. And I want you to look at what this man teaches us about having goals in our lives. And in Joshua chapter 14, we see a man who has gone through the 40 years of watching all the naysayers die in the desert. And now they are ready for the conquest. And we see him, an old, elderly statesman, coming, and he says this in verse 10. He says, "And now behold, the Lord has kept me alive, and he said these 45, as he said for these 45 years. Ever since the Lord spoke this word to Moses, while Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now here I am today, 85 years old. As yet I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so now my strength is for war, both for going out and for coming in. Now therefore, give me this mountain of which the Lord spoke in that day. For you have heard in that day that how the Anakim were there and that the cities were great and fortified. It may be that the Lord will be with me, and I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord said." And Joshua blessed him and gave him Hebron to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, as an inheritance. And Hebron, therefore, became the inheritance of Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, to the day, because he wholly followed the Lord God of Israel. I think we can find five principles coming out of this man's life about setting goals. And the first one that we see comes right out of verses 10 through 12, where he says, hey, God has kept me alive, God has sustained me, he has watched over me. And he comes down to verse 2, he says, "Now therefore give me this mountain." And he knows what he's asking. He knows it's going to be a challenge. The first principle is we need to set goals that are exciting yet difficult. We need to set goals that are exciting and yet difficult. One of the greatest things my wife has challenged me to do is to set goals in my life. When we first got married, we sat down and we said, what are some things we want to accomplish in the first 10 years of our marriage? And we named some of these. We wanted to both have an enjoyable vocation, and God granted us both that. She is a stay-at-home mom, and she works very hard with our three girls. And God's allowed me to serve in my home church, an honor I never expected to happen. I came home to Pensacola without a job, and I walked in on a Sunday morning, and they said, "Stan, how would you like to work part-time for us?" I said, "Well, I can do it for 6 months," and that was almost 10 years ago. And so God has given both myself and Kristen that goal. He's given us careers that we both enjoy. We said we want to go on a Western vacation. We want to go out west to all the national parks. And so we saved our money up. We flew out to Salt Lake. We went out to Yellowstone and to Arches and to the national parks out there. And we just toured around. And that was another goal that we'd set. We said, we want to go to Australia also. That's a pretty lofty goal. And God allowed us to go on a mission trip to Australia. And we were able to go there, meet some great people. Dan Kemp is an evangelism director there. He took great care of us. We were able to minister in that country and to see a place we'd never thought we would see. And God fulfilled that goal. We wrote these goals down. And God taught us through that experience that we needed to set goals that were exciting and yet challenging. After about 7 years of marriage, we, on our anniversary, sat down in a restaurant and we said, okay, we've accomplished a lot of these goals. What do we want to do next? And so we were able to write out some more goals. I want to challenge you today. Set goals for your life that are challenging and exciting. Write them down. If you'll write them down, they say if you write down 10 goals, you'll accomplish 7 out of 10 of those just by writing them down. And don't set goals you know you can easily attain. You need to set goals that only God can help you fulfill. You need to set goals that will challenge you, will stretch you, will stretch your faith. And that's exactly what Caleb did. He set a goal that only God could help him to fulfill. Well, number two, we see in this man's life right out of verse 11, be prepared to take action to attain your goals. Be prepared to take action to attain your goals. He says, and yet I am as strong this day as on the day Moses sent me, just as my strength was then, so now is my strength for war, both now for going out and for coming. He said, I'm ready for battle. I'm ready to do what it takes to obtain this goal. God has given me the power, the strength, and I'm now ready to go out to obtain this goal. One of our first goals that we set was we wanted to go to Israel, to the Holy Land. Our pastor, he occasionally takes trips there, and I was scheduled to go on a mission trip to Turkey, and I went to him one day, I said, Pastor, I'm going to Turkey, I know you're going to Israel, is there any way we can work these two trips? He said, I've got an extra ticket. Because we've got enough people on this trip, I'll pay for your way. If you'll pay your wife's way, then we'll get you to Israel. And so he allowed us to go on that trip to Israel to see the Holy Land. And God allowed us to fulfill that goal that we had to be in that place that we thought was, you know, just a goal that maybe whenever we retired we would obtain. But we were prepared by saving our money, by doing these things to attain these goals. You need to make sacrifices. If you're going to obtain these goals, you've got to make sacrifices. There's an account of Charles Journeycakes, who was the chief of the Delawares. And there's a college out in Muskogee, Oklahoma, that this group of Indians helped to found, and it's a Baptist college. And on the cornerstone of one of the buildings there, Charles Journeycakes had this written. He says, we have been broken up six times and been moved six times. We have been despoiled of our property. We thought when we moved across the Missouri River and had paid for our homes in Kansas that we were safe. But in a few years, the white man wanted our country. We had good farms. We built comfortable houses and big barns. We had schools for our children and churches where we listened to the same gospel the white man listens to. Then the white man came into our country from Missouri and drove off our cattle and horses. If our people followed them, they were killed. We tried to forget these things, but we would never forget that the white man brought us the blessed gospel of Jesus Christ, the Christian's hope. This more than pays for all we have suffered. Charles Journeycakes, chief of the Delawares, April 1886. They were prepared to sacrifice. And sacrifice they did to obtain these goals. The goal of having a place where they could live, raise their children, and share the gospel with people. We need to be creative. We need to make sacrifices. And we need to stay sharp. Don't you know it was a hard thing for Caleb to stay sharp those 45 years? I mean, he has to watch all these people who were the naysayers. He has to watch them die. He's got to see all these negative people who they have no hope. The only thing they've got to do is, the only thing they've got left to do is to die in the desert. And he's got to watch this for these 45 years. He had to stay focused and to stay sharp. If you want to capitalize on an opportunity that comes your way, you've got to stay sharp. You've got to stay in God's Word. You've got to stay in God's service. Whenever I was doing my master's degree here, I was always amazed at the students who would never serve in a church while they were doing their education. They wouldn't be an usher. They wouldn't teach a Sunday school class. They wouldn't take a position. Because they say, well, I'm just going to wait until I get out of seminary. Well, there's no way you can stay sharp as a person called to the gospel ministry if you're not doing the ministry. And I want to encourage you today, if you're not involved in ministry right now, get involved. Find some, volunteer your time, go to a church, maybe teach an RA class, do something that will help you stay sharp in ministry. Don't think you're just in the waiting room of ministry, because you're not. Because God's called you to this place, and He expects you to be involved in ministry. He expects you to be leaving those gates right now, going out there and doing something. And by doing that, God will bless you, and God will keep you sharp. Be prepared to take action to attain your goals. Number three, be patient in obtaining lifelong goals. In that same verse 12, he said, and you've heard in that day how the Anakim were there, and the cities were great and fortified. And it may be that the Lord will be with me, and I shall be able to drive them out. Caleb had to be persistent. He had to be patient. He had to wait for this opportunity to come. 45 years he had to wait. He had to be patient in obtaining a lifelong goal. Some goals come very quickly. Some goals take a lifetime. And I want to challenge you today to set goals far out in the future that you know it will take a while for you to obtain. When I was just a boy, my sister graduated from high school and went to college, and she began to get the Newsweek magazine. This was during the Iran crisis where our hostages, 52 of them, were captured at the embassy there in Tehran for 444 days. And she would get the Newsweek magazines, and when they would come in, of course, she didn't want to read them, but I did. And as a young boy, I was captivated by this country called Iran. And I would keep these Newsweek magazines. This is magazines from that time when we sent in a rescue team that went to Desert One there. And through some accidents, we lost many of our troops because they, in the sandstorm where they were trying to refuel their helicopters, they ran into to a C-130 parked there in the desert. They were getting ready to fly in and rescue the hostages there at that embassy compound in Tehran. And God birthed in my heart a desire to go to that country as a young boy. And I was so captivated by that, and I said in my heart, I remember the day when I said, I want to go to that country one day. And I want to see what's there. And God allowed me in 1999 to go to Istanbul, Turkey, and there to walk into the embassy of the Iranian Republic and to obtain a visa and to go with a team of five other people and to get on an Airbus A320. And we flew in at 3:30 in the morning to Mirabad Airport in Tehran. We had Bibles in our luggage. And I'll never forget when I walked down the jetway and walking toward the security control, all the placards that were hanging up saying, we are going to bury the infidels of the West. We are going to destroy America. And these are hung in the airport. That was quite a welcome for a group of Americans coming in. And we were tired. And, of course, they took our passports and made photocopies. And they allowed us to go. And we went to the Mashhad Hotel there in Tehran, right there on Roosevelt Avenue. They used to name their streets after our American presidents, but there's not one called Jimmy Carter Avenue there. And the next morning, I woke up, and I ate breakfast, and I looked across the street, and there was this enormous compound with these magnificent ponderosa pines. Just a beautiful place, right? They carved out right in the middle of the city of Tehran, 10 million people, just a bustling metropolis. And I walked out, and there it was, sealed off, 15 acres, sitting right there in the heart of that city. And I walked down the brick wall that had graffiti painted on it, you know, pictures of the Statue of Liberty with a skull on her face and pictures of when we shot down the Iranian airliner accidentally, all those murals painted on those walls. And as I walked down the wall, I came to this concrete circle in the wall. And there was an eagle on that circle. And this concrete emblem was scratched and was chipped, but you could still make out the words, Embassy of the United States of America. And I stood there looking at that, saying, thank you, God, for allowing me to fulfill this goal that you put in my heart. And we were able to go out that throughout that country to three cities and to meet people, to share the gospel, to give out scriptures. And that was a goal that took well over 20 years to obtain. And then God allowed me to be a part of a group that was able to send sports teams back in there to do basketball camps. And God helped me to obtain a lifelong goal. But we've got to be patient. We've got to be persistent. You know, persistence is like wrestling a tiger. You don't quit when you get tired. You quit when the tiger gets tired. And if we're going to have lifelong goals, we've got to be persistent and we've got to be patient. Number four. We've got to refuse to let obstacles and people keep us from reaching our goals. You know, Caleb had to face this back in Numbers. He's got these 10 people Him and Joshua went into the land. They spied the land. They see it's a great land. Oh, there's some challenges. There's fortified cities. There's giants in the land. And they come back out and they said, we can do this. And the 10 spies said, there's no way. God has brought us out here to die. God has tricked us. We are going to, those people will kill us. Those are giants and we were grasshoppers. And Joshua and Caleb came and said, do not do this. Don't resist the call of God. You need to follow after him. And they rebelled right there in the desert. And of course, you know the rest of the story. All the adults died. 40-something years, they wandered in the desert. If you're going to refuse to let obstacles and people keep you from reaching your goals, you've got to avoid some people. There's some folks you've just got to avoid. Number one, you've got to avoid negative people. That's those 10 spies. These are the people that no matter what you want to do, it's not going to work. Our pastor calls them the cold water committee. They're the ones that are going to pour cold water on any idea, any vision, anything you want to do. They're there to say it won't work. It can't happen. That's the dumbest thing. We should never have done this. You know, it's just negative, negative, negative. And you've got to avoid those kind of people. You've got to resist being around because, you know, negativity is attractive in some ways. It feeds our dark side. It feeds our flesh because it's real easy to start saying, well, we can't do that. Because the evil one's coming along and he's saying, you're right. There's no way you can obtain this goal. God's brought you out here. He's brought to this point and he has left you to die. And there'll be those who'll say, that's right. God has left us. We've got to go do our own thing now. And you've got to avoid those kind of people. You've got to avoid the doubters. These are the hand-wringers of, well, I just don't think we can. We don't have enough money. You know, just don't think that's just something we ought to do. These are the doubters. Now, these people aren't with you. You get in your churches, and you'll be going a direction, and these people come, Pastor, brother, I just don't think we can do this. I just don't see how we can. And you know what? Those folks aren't with you. And they're going to cast stones at you. They're going to throw things at you. They're going to throw up accusations. And they're going to poison the well. They're going to go around to the people. Well, I don't know why we're doing this. There's no way we can do this thing. The pastor taught me a long time ago, we had a gentleman in our church who was very negative about everything. And nothing. We couldn't please this guy to save our lives. I came into his office one day. I said, Pastor, what do we do about this guy? I mean, we've been working and he's negative. He doubts everything we want to do. He said, let me show you something. He called our financial secretary. He said, run me a given report on this person. He said, just watch this. The moment she called back, he said, goose egg. He said, Stan, the loudest boos always come from the cheapest seats. He said, that guy's not with us. Why we don't need to spend a lot of time on trying to get him with us because he's got to have a heart change and we can't do that. Only God can. He said, loudest boos are going to come from the cheapest seats. That's the folks. They're not going to be on the team with you. They just want to sit back and throw stones at you. So you need to avoid those kind of people. You need to avoid the negative people, the doubters. You need to avoid the compromisers. My brother was a very successful recruiter for a hospital, making well into six figures, and he has five children. And doing well, I mean, he just, God was blessing him, and then God called him in the ministry. And he talked to me about that, and I was like, well, you know, if God's telling you to do this, that you need to follow him. And well, he went to be bivocational. He's still working at his other job, you know, being a youth pastor in another church, and then another church called him to be the pastor, to come to be full-time. And they were going to pay him less than, you know, $25,000 a year. He said, Stan, you know, I believe this church is calling me. I believe God's telling me to go. I was like, David, are you sure? Man, you got five kids. I mean, you're making great money. I mean, and this church, this is a meat grinder. I mean, they have chewed up pastor after pastor after pastor. About the average tenure is 6 months for this little church. He said, God's calling me to go. I'm going to go. It's like, okay. You know, there was, you know, I was one of those people. You know, his brother, no faith. Other people in our, you know, saying, Dave, hey, why don't you do something else? Why don't you stick with this other church over here? Why don't you compromise? And he said, no, God's called me. He went to that church. Their first Sunday, they had 17, not including his family. Today, about 4 years later, they're running well over 200. They're getting ready to build a new building. God's blessed their family. He's baptizing people left and right. I mean, God has just said again and again, this was the right thing to do. You didn't listen to those who wanted you to compromise. You didn't listen to those who didn't have faith. You did the right thing. You followed my vision. You went after the right thing. Well done, good and faithful servant. So you got to avoid those compromises. And sometimes you might find yourself being one of those people. I've found myself in that position. You've got to avoid the short-sighted people as well. These are folks, the vision that you put out there is too big. When our pastor came to Olive, one of the former staff members told him, he said, now listen, you got all the buildings and all the land you're ever going to need. You'll never outgrow these things. Well, in 2 years, we were running three services, packing those out, and it was obvious we needed a new building. And through a vision process, God led us to build a new worship center and to buy more land, and God has been blessing us ever since. But that was a short-sighted vision. And there'll be people who will come along and say, hey, you know, you don't need to grow this church any bigger. We've got a great church. We don't need another building. We don't need to do some kind of extension over here. We don't need another Sunday school class. The vision's big enough. Avoid short-sighted people. The people you need to be around are those who have vision. I get around people like Dr. Paul Negrut, who's in Romania, and I'll spend some time with him when I go over to Romania, and I come back saying, I am such a pygmy when it comes to vision and faith. This man who has, they have almost nothing, they have grown such a tremendous ministry over there, and I just find myself saying, Lord, help me. And that challenge, you need to hang around people like that, people who have vision, people who have passion, people who have focus. Be around those kind of people. They will challenge you, and they will spur you on to be a person that does not compromise and is not negative, but sees the vision of God and follows after that. Well, the last thing I want to give you in these last remaining moments. Now, you can have all kind of goals in your life, and you can set them, and you can accomplish them, but if you don't accomplish the goals God's given you and set for your life, you've done nothing. Wood, hay, and stubble. A godless goal is a worthless goal. It will mean nothing in eternity. It may bring you a big house. It may bring you a promotion. It may give you prestige, but it will count for absolutely nothing in the eternal scheme of things. We see there in Joshua chapter 14, where Joshua blesses him in verse 13 and gave him Hebron. And the reason why he gave him this and blessed him, it says that because he wholly followed the Lord of Israel. In Psalms 127, it says in verse 1, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. Over in Philippians chapter 4, chapter 3 and verse 14, Paul says, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. He said, these are not my goals, these are God's goals. And you need to find what God's goals are for your life, and you need to obtain those. In Ephesians chapter 2, you know, we will quote Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9 about being saved by grace, and we'll leave out verse 10. It says, for we are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. If He's prepared those good works for us beforehand, He means for us to obtain them and to find out what those are. And you should be finding out what God's goals are for your life, and you should be about those. Jesus said, I must be about my Father's business. Caleb was a man who did great things because he followed God's plan. He sought after God. He followed Him with all his heart. And if you will set the goals that God gives to you, if you will follow after those, if you will find those, you will be a person who lays up treasure in heaven. Don't set godless goals. Don't set goals that feed your flesh. Set goals and obtain goals that God has set for you. Before coming to Christ, my goal was to make a lot of money. My goal was to have a nice house somewhere. My goal was me, me, me. But on September the 11th, 1984, as I read in Romans chapter 3 in my bedroom, as a 17-year-old young man, and God said, you're a sinner, you're going to hell. If you don't turn around, repent, and follow after me, you will never see me. You will plunge into eternity. Your life will be empty. You'll have no purpose. You may accomplish all you want to accomplish, but it will mean absolutely nothing. And beside my bed that night, I got down and I began to pray. I said, God, I've been going my own way, doing my own thing. Please save me. And right there that night, God saved me. But not only saved me, He changed my life. And the goals that I once thought were important, were precious, I began to say, that means nothing. That has no fulfillment. I'd wanted to be in the Air Force as a pilot, and God kept saying, Stan, that is the wrong goal. I want you to go to seminary. I want you to be a pastor. And I said, I don't want to do that. I have no desire to do that. But after I got saved, God began to say, Stan, this is what you need to do. This is what I've called you to do. And when I surrendered to God to do that, He began to bless my life. He brought a woman into my life that changed my life, who has challenged me, who has loved me, been there for me, I never would have met her if I had not sought after God's goals, if I had not found out what His will was and gone after Him. I want to end today with a prayer. I'm going to read it to you, and then I'm going to pray, and we'll be dismissed. But this comes from Sir Francis Drake. Whenever he set out to be the first man to circumnavigate the world, and he read this prayer in 1577 from Portsmouth, England. He said, "Disturb us, O Lord, when we are too well pleased with ourselves, when our dreams have come true because we have dreamed too little, when we arrive safely because we sailed too close to the shore. Disturb us, O Lord, when with the abundance of things we possess, we have lost our thirst for the waters of life. Having fallen in love with life, we have ceased to dream of eternity. And in our effort to build a new earth, we have allowed our vision of the new heaven to dim. Disturb us, O Lord, to dare more boldly, to venture on wider seas, where the storms will show your mastery, where losing sight of the land, we shall find the stars. We ask you to push back the horizons of our hopes and to push us in the future in strength, courage, hope, and love. We ask this in the name of our captain, who is Christ Jesus." Let's pray. Disturb us, O Lord. Challenge us, Father. Where we have gone our own way, where we have been short-sighted, where we have shot too low, rather than having a vision that comes from you, we've sought our own. Dear God, I pray you'll convict us of that. I pray, Father, that we will be people as Caleb was, a man who says, "Give me this mountain." I pray, Father, that we will look for the mountains that only you can deliver, and we will ask for that, and we will set out on that journey, saying, "If God is pleased with me, He will give me this mountain." Dear God, I pray for conquerors in this room today. Those who would say, "Through the Lord's strength alone, I can do this." Those who would set a lofty goal that they could never obtain apart from your strength. Dear God, I thank you for the visionaries that have come before us, those who have planted this seminary, those who are even here today who have helped to grow this school. Dear God, may we look to their example. And Father, I pray that one day others will look to ours as well. And we pray this now in Jesus' name, our captain.